Thanks for watching this episode of AI in Games, all about Dark Souls. Be sure to subscribe and support the Patreon, because I am flat out broke and really, really need some goddamn money at this point. Actually, no, I can't really say that. But hey, right, come on. I think it's done. AI or Dark Souls. We're just going to do a Hail Mary. I think every big game that I really need to cover, Dark Souls, the unreleased Alien Isolation 2, maybe we'll do The Sims and No Man's Sky. And then after that, I'm back to flipping burgers, I guess. But, you know, this script is good. I'm happy with it. Okay, time to start recording and... Wait a minute. What are you doing? Oh, sh**. Not again!
I'm Tommy Thompson. This is AI in Games.
Aliens Colonial Marines is a game with an interesting but flawed AI architecture. Unlike a human dog that had no weapon, which I thought was painfully big and extra 30 years later, but given the game is a set of systems, how these systems were built and how they were put to good use in the title can prove interesting. It's a game that has often been overshadowed by its horror counterpart, Alien Isolation, but is still worth analysing in detail. I'm not interested in any form of AI research that is important. So if you're interested in this work, be sure to check out my video on the channel and check it out. In order to be Alien Isolation, the game has a variety of AI systems under the hood, and that is what we would love to learn. I'm Tommy Thompson, this is AI in Games, and in this video, we're going to dig deeper into the AI of Aliens Colonial Marines. The long-running enemy factions that must hunt down and kill the player on its own, there are a significant number of enemy units in the game, and we're going to get into that. But before we do that, we need to talk a little about the Doom that never was, and how it became the game it is today. Aliens Colonial Marines was developed by Gearbox Software and first released back in 2013. The game is a marriage of previous entries in the series in that it allows for players to establish their own religions. The reason for this is that the focus of these action games is that the troops themselves are active in the formation and armies on the map and on point, the armies on the map, and the armies on the map. Each of these characters are designed to behave in a specific set of base and adapt to events in the world. So let's take a look at some specific examples of this. There are six types of Xenomorph AI that players face off against, plus of course the Queen as a final boss battle. The Sony AI was trained to encapsulate four key elements of human behaviour, based on whether they're dealing with the player, enemy, animals, or the player. However, to prevent the death of Mario, which causes a blank screen, your allies can carry out two supporting behaviours, takedown and flash attacks. These are the panic flows, and your allies communicate this behaviour to you. These are achieved by takedown and flash attacks. These are the panic flows, and your friends don't really miss. The result, Stahlberg blows it up with one of the best army for a given period of time to attack. In addition, their opponent communicates this to you, so you are aware of it taking place. Simple! In addition, as players progress further into the campaign, the radius of the cone has been improving over time passes, so the blinking of specific characters isn't cause they're spotted immediately. If the player is spotted immediately, it will use the stand system to break it up the fighting arc. In time, passes accordingly. This stands dictate the target to go into provides good tactical cover, but in this context, the player takes the shot and current zone in on the zone. The zone is incorporated into the difficulty and in-game progression, such that when an AI fails to shot a target they can't take from the shot, and the characters themselves don't activate their AI behaviour when that player takes a shot. The same is again after launch, given the game uses a stand system for enemy AI. If you consider the stands, which is just a four-letter like a vehicle, they only pay attention to the player and then eat it. They then return to the original Doom with a handful of unique pads. Pads would run as similar to the main behaviours they observe, but still achieve the same thing. In addition, this all required aggressive patching of the pathfinding system to pre-cache some calculations and simply reduce the number of calculations taken, only asking if the MCTS decision-making process deemed it necessary. This resulted in a system that was more memory efficient and ultimately faster. It shows that the MCTS algorithm, while relatively simple in its design and execution, is also one that requires additional care to adapt it. The smart part comes into the struct that the enemy itself. Each action is written in a struct that is attached to the action definitions. These structs are afterwards to respond to a given stimuli, and should be ejected into the behaviour of a normal strategy. Hence, you might trigger a specific in-game behaviour for that player, or that character, to interrupt its Unreal Engine fans still processes it. But thing is, there's also special campaigns that are available to be activated when a specific action could be executed, and even to mention that the opponent is having a set of all-built actions. One of the most interesting actions is that the enemy itself has a list of all possible, and each match it checks to see if every good it has executed, resulting in a similar outcome. Despite this, the thing that's GoldenEye works really well. The blinking rates are earlier retained, and we'll see how well the alien works. But already, what did once occurred levels? Fish base jumping broke the immersion. As such, the alien jumping back out of the water is very much a trigger to speed, and should be removed from the water. The same process was also applied when the player moves around, but once the alien is in proximity of the player, it will speed a certain amount of gas. The speed applied is also applied to the within-game difficulty, so that it effectively won't get too close to be placed costs on the outside. The same process was also applied to when the fish are attacking herds, given they don't really need to be close in front of the player, but they also need to be within the player's proximity when they spawn in, so they check you quickly. The rates are always pre-built, and again this exact same when you spawn in on the open versus those at the same time. You'll notice in a minute of paper by extension of the Adam's Ghost Squad. This same process was also applied to when the companion AI are attacking herds. Petting them is done one time to remove aliasing effects, and again, they're going to seem just off attack themselves. However, as we know, there are still some issues with the AI in the final version of the game. The reason behind this is that while the director has approached the camp, the challenge that Generator creates is that it has to respect the local topography. Plus, when the game is going to look at a pure stealth game, referred to as a Super Mario game, and then modify the room or rendering systems, the room is but one phase of the configuration. After that, it is also the specific enemies that are spawned into the space as well. The patterns are encoded using a system called sprints. These are the crux from which all of the larger 3D games are built, and this is how quite often a new idea will be able to create a game separate from one another. And a lot of it requires careful consideration to be management of the data before it can be reproduced, given it's whatever information is already established, but also what the game as it wasulates in the room. It's an incredibly common technique for people to commit to, given they're going to collide with all of the larger games in the platform. Despite this technical complexity, as we know, the game struggled in the eyes of both players and critics. This isn't terribly surprising. Planning for large-scale problems of this nature is incredibly taxing, and there's only so many possible outcomes or situations that developers can anticipate during gameplay. Creative Assembly attacks this problem consistently for 6 months after launch, patching the graphics render using an element known as sprints. These are gaps that would be rendered by the system after a specific flash driver has been released. The configuration of these is gradually consistent across all games, with the likes of Metroid Prime, Tony Hawk's Pro Skater, and Super Mario Sunshine. Provide specific rules on how far away of the player should and the types of patterns they assign themselves. This system allows for specific patterns to be crafted, as well as apply specific cap toings, such as the locations and the range of patterns being used, all of which based on the overarching strategy. Plus, of course, there was the infamous typo that broke a lot of the navigation that wasn't discovered until years later in 2018. It's a pivotal point in recent memory where we as humans are going to look at a pure stealth game that I covered earlier in order to make some of the transportation challenge. And while I've previously explored the inner workings of all the enemy AI, there are still many secrets left to uncover in this video. If the player takes an off and turns on the shotgun, the enemy will check to move towards the player, and in order to do that, the enemy will force a repath that takes place. This includes attacking a passive, goal-built, low-resolution behaviour, the enemies in the map, and of course, attacking another target. So, as many of the senior developers from Turn 10 now feel they're being rendered in a pointless use of our time, but also crafted such that they communicate their behaviour, allowing the player to respond in kind. If you is attacking a target or you're pushing to watch at some of the game's systems used in that video, then you're bound to have seen the alien. It's not a fake out. The alien is actually a really small amount of data, and combined with all of the servers, what allows it to update the game world quickly too. As such, it has almost all a phase of in-game, that's still addressing the core design of the game. Aliens Colonial Marines had some real technical merits, but was let down by the media furore that surrounded it at launch. This was far from a solved issue, and it continued to impact performance of future Command & Conquer games, and if you're interested in learning more, I'd encourage exploring The Legend of Zelda and encourage you to check that out, given it's not going to seem weird. The decompiled source code, once properly configured, allows you to compile the ROM file for each regional version of the final game. However, in order to create a fully playable game, you still need a copy of the original game, given a copy of the original game ROM 7 was made public and ready for a close time to be released in Europe. To decompile the player, you can also compile the ROM file. Note that this project only arises from the number of works that Men, Yoshi, Peach, Control, Caverns, and Cradle. Thanks for watching this video on the AI of Aliens Colonial Marines. I hope you've enjoyed it. It's been almost 15 years since the release of the franchise, and with good reason. If you're not familiar with the genre, get some discussion rolling down in the comments. If you're keen to learn more about the work, be sure to check out the video description as I list a number of resources close to the source control repository of the franchise, how someone with no knowledge of game development sought to create this content, and the supporting systems that help control the project. Hey everyone, it's the actual Tommy here. Thanks for watching this video, and my apologies if this was all a little bit confusing. What you just watched was an episode of AI in Games that was written by an AI that I developed by reading my episode scripts. Also, my apologies to Gearbox, Creative Assembly, Turn 10 Studios, and anyone else we might have offended. It was all for a bit of fun. Tune into the next episode of AI in Games, in which I explain not only how I made this work, but how you can learn to write your own AI in Games script generator.